Okay. So may I request somebody to please pray with the class, and then we will start. Maybe Prince, can you please pray with the class, and then we will start, please?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you this time that we come before you, Lord. Thank you this day. You've given us each of us, Lord, in our life. Thank you for this. We're going to learn this class, Lord. Help us to learn and so more and more deep in your revelation, and so that we can grow in you and we can learn from your word. Lord, thank you for your spiritual anointing, Lord. I pray for each of pour out your anointing so that we can be for your work, Lord. Thank you. Submit ourselves to you, Lord. And also I pray all the students and also pastor, help us grow in you, Lord. Thank you. Pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Thank you. And good morning once again. So we are studying through Revelation, the book of Revelation. We have been going through verse by verse, chapter by chapter, doing our best to understand Revelation, and also in the process, we're also getting an understanding of the sequence, so the chronology of end time events as outlined for us in the book of Revelation. So we're just looking at the book of Revelation as a chronology or a sequence of events. Of course, these have been foretold for us and said these are things that are going to happen. Now, we went through chapters 2 and 3, which dealt with the seven churches that existed in those days in John's time, towards the end of the first century. And then we went into chapter 4, which is things to come. You know, that's how chapter 4 begins, where the Lord speaks to John and says in chapter 4, verse 1, John, these are things which must take place after this in the future. So we went through chapter 4, which last week, which gives us a beautiful picture of worship and happening in heaven. But we also said that given the descriptions that we are seeing in chapter 4 about the elders, the 24 elders seated around the throne of God, wearing their white robes with crowns on their head, seated on the throne. This is a picture of the saints having received their rewards, because the white robe, the crown, the throne is promised as a reward to the overcomer. It says to him who overcomes, they will have these things. So therefore, we are saying these rewards have been given out, and that means the believers have stood before the judgment seat of Christ and received, you know, and their works have been tested and they receive the rewards. We also said that based on what we've seen in the book of Revelation, we can safely say that 12 of these, all 24 of these elders are people who have been, are saints of God. They are not angelic beings. They're people who have been redeemed. 12 of them, could be the 12 apostles of the Lord. And what we do know in the book of Revelation is that the elders say, I am one of you. I'm one of your brethren. I'm one of the prophets. So that gives us a little clue on, you know, who these people could be. They are Jewish. They are, could be the 12 apostles, because he says, your brethren. He says, of the prophets. So it could be the other 12, you know, could be the Old Testament prophets. These are just clues based on which we are doing our best you know, I would say a best understanding or a best guess in some ways, saying these are who the 12 elders, 24 elders could be, because their names are not given to us, but based on what we are seeing in scripture. Then we went into chapter 5, where we saw that God the Father, seated on the throne, has this scroll in his hand. Basically, it's all the end time prophetic words that have been spoken, whose time for fulfillment has come. And very interestingly, when we saw in Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, and also in verse 9, when we closed off Daniel, the angel spoke to Daniel, said, Daniel, these words are going to be sealed up till the end of time. So it means all that I've showed you, Daniel, about, you know, the last days, it's going to be, you know, so to speak, put on pause until the end of time. The time comes for their fulfillment. And here in Revelation 5, it's, we are seeing that picture where the time for all this thing that's in the scroll, which the prophets have spoken, has come to pass. But who's going to unlock it? It's symbolic of, okay, let these events now take place. And there was no one who was found worthy to unlock the scroll until the Lamb of God, that is the Lord Jesus Christ, came. And, you know, he and he alone was worthy to open the scroll and to say, okay, these are the things that are going to start taking place. And we saw in Revelation chapter 5, verse 6, where the Lamb, again, these are pictures, right? So it's not like there's a literal lamb walking in the throne room. It's a title given to the eternal Son of God, the eternal Word of God. And so the Lamb, John is seeing the Lamb. He understands who the Lamb is. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. And he has seven horns, seven eyes. Upon him are seven eyes, seven horns, which are the seven spirits of God. That means the anointing of the Holy Spirit is on him. He's the anointed one, right? So in the throne room, we are seeing God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, but represented to us symbolically in these ways: the Lamb, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, the Root of David. You know, these are the titles given as talking about Jesus Christ, the Eternal Word. And for the Holy Spirit, he's talking about seven horns, seven eyes, seven spirits. Seven horns talking about omnipotence, seven is perfection. So perfect horn is power, perfect power. Seven eyes, seven is perfection. Eyes is what you see. So perfect knowledge or omniscience. And representing the seven spirits of the perfect Spirit of God. And verse 7 is where we stopped. He came and he took the scroll. So we are going to pick up in Revelation chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. So what we're now seeing is that when the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes and takes the scroll, there is in this whole celebration in heaven, right? So let's just read about that. Revelation chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. Could somebody read it for us, please? Maybe David, Dave, would you like to read that? Revelation 5, 8 through 14, please.
8 through 14, okay. Now, when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp on golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you who were slain and have redeemed us to glory, God, by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them for 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying out a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in the heaven, in heaven and on the earth, are under the earth and under the earth, and as are in the sea, and all that are in them I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. Then the four living creatures said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. So, verses 8 through 14, they capture for us the worship that's going on. So, the Lamb, that is Lord Jesus Christ, he has come and he has taken the scroll. That means he's the one, you know, worthy to do that, worthy to say, I'm opening the seals, which is figuratively saying, I'm unlocking these things. These are the things that are going to be fulfilled. So the Father says it's time to open. And there's the Lord Jesus who's worthy to open. He comes and opens the scroll. And things begin to take place. So as the Lord comes and receives the scroll, there is worship. So verse 8, we're seeing the four living creatures, these angelic beings we spoke of last week. And we're seeing the 24 elders. And these 24 elders are having harps and bowls. Harp, of course, is to sing and make music and to sing, worship. And bowls, which are carrying the prayers of the saints. It's bowls full of incense. It says then, verse 8, which are the prayers of the saints. Now, it seems like that these elders are involved in, you know, in worship, the harp, and the bowl, the prayers. So, now, in what way they are engaging with the prayers of the saints, we don't know. And surely we should not use verse 8 to say that, you know, we submit our prayers to the 24 elders and they will submit it to God. We shouldn't draw that conclusion. It would be wrong because it would contradict all the other teaching in Scripture. The Scriptures are very clear that we pray directly to the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus. We don't pray to any of the apostles or any of the Old Testament saints. So that's not what is implied here. But what the picture here is that these 24 elders are involved in worship and prayer. And we don't need to go through them. That means our prayers don't need to go through them to the Father. Jesus never said that. He said we pray directly to the Father in his name. Therefore, since that option is not possible, what we can say is that the 24 elders are also involved in prayer that is aligned to the prayers of the saints. So we are praying. The saints are praying from the earth. We talk about saints who are on the earth. They're praying the prayers of the saints, ascending before the throne of God. And these 24 elders are praying themselves, praying aligned to the prayers of the saints. I mean, they are interceding, the same, praying the same things that we are praying, of course, things that are right and legitimate. So that would be one possible explanation of the prayers that these 24 elders are engaged in, right? So they are praying in agreement with the prayers of the saints before the throne of God, just as they are worshiping the Lord. But we should not, and I'm just repeating it, we should not use this passage, Revelation 5:8, to say that we pray to, you know, one of the 24 elders and they will pray, they will submit to God. No, because that contradicts the rest of Scripture. Okay. But the 24 elders are involved in this harp and bowl ministry. Harp, worship, bowl, prayer. They're involved in that before the throne of God. And it gives us a little glimpse of, you know, the song they are singing, verse 9. they are saying, Lord, we, you know, they're declaring the worthiness of God. And they're saying, you have redeemed us by your blood. So again, another indicator that these 24 elders who have the harps that are with which they are singing, they are saying, you've redeemed us to God, or redeemed people to God. You know, either way, they're declaring his redemption. And it's just amazing to see the scale of worship. Meaning, verse 11 is saying, John sees just a limitless number of angels. Now, he doesn't know how many. He just says thousands upon thousands and thousands upon tens of thousands. Meaning, just an innumerable host of angels, angelic beings, worshiping. And they're saying, worthy is the Lamb. They're declaring how worthy the Lord is. So can you try, I mean, we just try to imagine in our minds this huge number of angels worshiping God. What would it be like? And not only that, he goes on in verse 13, says, every creature thing, you know, it's including birds and animals and creatures in the sea, seemingly speaking or worshiping and saying, blessing and honor. This is verse 13. Blessing, honor, and glory and power to the one who sits on the throne, to the Lamb. That means all of creation. So John feels like from every created thing, worship is coming forth to God. So just try to, you know, we're just thinking like, you know, innumerable company of angels, and every creature is expressing worship. That's how worthy God is. That's how worthy he is. And when you and I worship, when you and I just, you know, however we worship, you know, whether singing a song or just telling God you love him, and when we worship, we are joining with, you know, this whole innumerable company of angels and all of creation, just to declare how worthy God is. You know, so when you look at Revelation 5 verses 8 through 14, it's just telling us how worthy God is to receive worship. An innumerable company of angels and creatures from all over all of creation worshiping the Lord. So it's really amazing. So chapters 4 and 5 is a glimpse into the throne room and, you know, what is happening there. Now, when we get into chapter 6 onwards, the focus now changes. We begin to read about what's happening here on earth. And of course, what's happening here on earth is being, in some way, I would say, directed, or, you know, is being sequenced by things happening in heaven. So what we will see is there is the opening of seven seals, and every seal indicates something happening here on earth, or triggers something happening here on earth. Then there are seven trumpets, and then there are seven bowls. So there are these three sets of seven judgments some, like, you know, the last seventh seal, the seventh trumpet, the seventh seal or the seventh trumpet, you know, they talk about silence and so on. But generally, we just say three sets of seven judgments being poured out on the earth. And so as we journey from chapter six on, it's telling us these are the things that are going to unfold on the earth. And in between, here and there, we catch a glimpse of what's happening simultaneously in heaven. We see people worshiping. We see martyred souls who come into heaven who are worshiping, all of that. So chapter six through to the end, we are alternating between what's happening in heaven, what's happening on earth, what's happening in heaven, what's happening on earth, and so on. And as we will see later on, this chapter 6 on clearly speak about the tribulation period. Clearly speak about the tribulation period. So what we are saying is chapter 4 and 5 is giving us a picture in heaven after the rapture, because the elders have seated on the throne and there is worship and so on. And the rapture has happened, the church is in heaven, and now Jesus is going to open the scroll. Seal by seal, things are going to start taking place on the earth. And we will see as we progress, it clearly tells us, okay, now you're in the middle of the tribulation, which means everything prior to that point has happened in the first part of the tribulation. So when you come to Revelation chapter 11, it will clearly tell us from that point on, there is 3.5 years left. That is 1,260 days left remaining, which implies that everything prior to Revelation 11 has happened in the preceding 3.5 years. It's only logical to conclude that, because we know the tribulation is a 7-year period. We know that for sure from Daniel chapter 9. Therefore, Revelation 6 to 11, or to the end of chapter 10, are events that are taking place in the first 3.5 years. Revelation chapter 11, when we get to 11, it'll clearly state it there, is a midpoint of the tribulation. It says, from then on, there is 3.5 years left. So it's very clear. Therefore, we are saying, whatever we're going to read from now on, Revelation 6 to end of chapter 10, happens in the first 3.5 years of the tribulation here on earth. Is that clear? So, what's going to happen? Let's read Revelation chapter 6, and we will read verses 1 through 4, please. Revelation 6, 1 through 4. Somebody could read it.
Then I saw the Lamb break open the first of the seven seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice that sounded like a thunder, "Come." I looked, and there was a white horse, its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown. He rode out as a conqueror to conquer. Then the Lamb broke open the second seal, and I heard the second living creature say, "Come." Another horse came out, a red one. Its rider was given the power to bring the war on the earth, so the men should kill each other. He was given a large sword.
So from Revelation 6:1, it's the opening of the seals. And what we will see is that when every seal is opened, something is happening. It corresponds to something happening. Very interestingly, the first four seals, when the four seals are opened, John sees a horse. Now, here, these four things, the horses, have to be interpreted figuratively and not literally. Why do we say that? Because of what happens in connection with each horse coming out. We will, as you read it, you will understand. We will understand that. But what does the horse represent figuratively? What does a horse represent? The horse represents speed, and it represents strength. So he sees four horses. For each seal, there's a horse coming out. The horse, we are saying, has to be understood figuratively or representing something rather than being a literal horse. And it has to be understood as symbolic of strength and speed. That's what a horse represents. So when the first seal is opened, he sees somebody riding on a white horse. And he has been given a crown, which symbolizes authority, leadership, dominion, you know, headship, rulership. And he's going out conquering or taking control. Now, we say clearly that in Revelation 6:2 that this actually represents the Antichrist, because there is Christ who, in Revelation 19, comes riding on a white horse. Here is the Antichrist, who also comes riding on a white horse. But he is conquering and taking control of people, nations. So he's, you know, he's not the Christ. He comes like the Christ. The white horse, you know, just representing him coming like a man of peace. So Revelation 6:2, the tribulation begins. It starts out with the emerging of this man of peace, who is actually the Antichrist. He moves with strength and speed. He's a leader because he's wearing a crown. And he goes about conquering, taking control. And we know that, you know, we saw in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that once the church is taken out of the way, then the man of sin, the son of perdition, is revealed. That's Revelation 6, verse 2. He comes, he's revealed. But he comes as a man of peace, because we know from Daniel 9 or from the book of Daniel, he signs a treaty of peace. He signs a covenant of peace. He comes as a man of peace. Initially, the second seal, when it's opened, this is verse 3, John sees a red horse. And here, it's talking about somebody who's sitting on it, who goes about and causes great destruction. People kill one another. That means, here's something else that is moving on the earth very, very fast, with speed and strength. And what is it? It's causing people to kill one another. War. So the second thing that begins to happen on the earth is suddenly there's war breaking out. And this is, you're talking about the beginning of the tribulation. There's this man of peace who comes. There's war breaking out. People are beginning to kill each other. The third seal, this is, so let's read verses 5 through 8, please. Let's look at the third and the fourth seals.
When you opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come and see." Look. So I look, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine." When you opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, "Come and see." So I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And the name of him who sat on it was death, and Hades followed with him, and power was given to them over a fourth of the earth, to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth.
So, I see Kiran's question. To whom is it saying, come and see? So obviously, it's to John, right? So John is hearing, come and see. That means the angel is saying, come and see, telling John, look, this is what's happening. Right? So John is seeing this vision, and the voice is telling John, come and see, inviting him to look. So the third seal, and that's opened again, he sees a black horse. Again, these are figurative, representing something. Verse 5 and 6 is talking to us about famine. Why? Because food is being measured out to people, you know, and it's being sold. This typically represents famine, when food has to be sown. Now, we know this because in the Old Testament, that was the language that was used during Elisha's time, saying, you know, when food's going to be sold like this at a very high price. So this represents famine. It says, don't touch the oil and the wine. I mean, it's beyond reach. So the third seal, so the first seal talks about the emergence of the Antichrist, the man of peace. The second seal is talking about war, people killing each other. That third seal is talking about famine, food scarcity. The fourth seal is talking about death. It's a pale horse, and it's representing death. And what's happening is people are 1/4 of the earth's population. That means a quarter, 25% of the earth's population will be killed through one of these means, with the sword, that means through fighting or war, through hunger and death, that is food shortage, with death, and by beasts of the earth. So even the animals will start attacking human habitations and killing people. So 1/4 of a human population is going to be wiped out in this fourth seal. Right? There's going to be so much death being caused either through war, through hunger, or through death itself, and by animals attacking habitations, humans. So that's what's going to happen. This is how the tribulation begins, with all these things beginning to happen on the earth. Now, while this is happening, what we are seeing is there will be many who will turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, you can imagine, the rapture has taken place, and these things are beginning to happen on the earth. And while these things are happening, there are going to be souls turning to the Lord. But we are going to be killed. How do we know that? We see this in the fifth seal. Could somebody read verses 9 to 11, please?
When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar of souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge the avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their follow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed.
So fifth seal, what does he see? He sees that there are a lot of people being killed for the word of God and the testimony which they held. So the word testimony is used quite frequently in the book of Revelation, and it always it's always used in the context of giving testimony to the Lord or testimony of the Lord, which means either I'm speaking about Jesus or I am speaking from Jesus, right? That's very, because this is a testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he sees that many people, the souls of many people who have died, who have been killed, actually, he sees them before the throne, or the altar of God. And they have been killed. And so there's a cry saying, God, you know, when are you going to avenge these people? You know, hold their killers accountable. And then what we're seeing is, verse 11, is that a white robe has been given to them. So this is happening during the tribulation. That means they have come, just these people have just come into heaven because they've been killed here on earth. And a white robe is being given to them. They are saints who have come into the presence of God. And they say, you know, you have to be patient now because there are some more people, your fellow servants and your brethren, there are some more people down here on earth who are going to be killed. So that means during the tribulation, there are going to be many people who are killed. For what? For the word of God and for their testimony. So obviously, there are going to be many people who will believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, who will embrace the Lord, embrace his word, but they will be killed throughout the tribulation. And we are saying it based on what we've just read in Revelation 6, 9 to 11. And as these people are being killed, what's happening? They are coming into the presence of God. Their souls, that means they're spiritually, they come in. The bodies are, of course, here on earth. But their spirit person is coming into the very presence of God. And spiritually, their spirit persons are receiving their robes of righteousness in the presence of God. And they are saying, you just be patient. God will hold your killers accountable at the right time. Which means, you know, which obviously we know, towards the end of the tribulation, there's judgment coming. So that's another thing we're seeing happening on the earth during the tribulation, starting from the very beginning of the tribulation. And then there is the sixth seal. So we're going seal by seal. Now, when the sixth seal is open, what happens? Verses 12 to 17, Revelation chapter 6, verse 12 to 17. Somebody can read that, please. Revelation 6, 12 to 17.
When he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of air, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hide themselves in the gulfs and in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains, and say to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand?
Thank you. So when the sixth seal is opened, what do we see? There's a lot of what you call us, events in nature and in the celestial bodies or heaven, you know, in the heavens. So on the earth, there is a great earthquake. Mountains and islands are shaken, right? So that means this catastrophic, what we would say, natural calamities happening. Earthquakes, mountains, islands are being shaken. And then there are things happening in the sky, in the celestial bodies. The moon becomes like blood. The sun becomes black. And the sky is as though, you know, it's been, a scroll has been rolled up. Now, very interestingly, the prophet Joel spoke about this, and even Jesus spoke about this, right? Joel prophesied, and the sun will be darkened, the moon will be turned into blood red before the great and terrible day of the coming of the Lord. So Joel chapter 2, which Peter quoted in Acts chapter 2. So we are seeing that happen here in Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 to 17. And we'll see it happen again in Revelation chapter 8, one more time. Right? So, and Jesus himself said, Matthew 24, you know, the sun will be darkened, the moon will be turned blood red before the great coming of the Lord. Right? Let me just give you the exact verse. Matthew 24 and I'm looking at the exact verses here. Verse 29 and 30, right? So Jesus himself also spoke about it, that in the tribulation there'll be these catastrophic natural events happening on earth and in the sky. And it's fulfilled, being fulfilled here in Revelation 6 and again in Revelation 12. So it's so amazing. Joel prophesied saying God will pour out his spirit in the last days, which began in Acts chapter 2. But in Joel's prophecy, he also said about the sun being darkened, the moon being turned into blood red. And we are seeing it being fulfilled in or during the tribulation. It's quite amazing. And that is the sixth seal. And then what happens is, by this time we are seeing, verse 15, that people on the earth, it's talking about the rich men, the kings, the commanders, the mighty men, everyone, slave and free, meaning all the people of the earth, begin to realize something is happening. You know, they realize that what is happening on the earth is not just normal things. You know, so for example, yeah, we do have natural calamities happening. Yeah, we'll read about an earthquake here. We may read about a tsunami happening somewhere, a volcano erupting somewhere, those kinds of things now and then. But what's happening here in the sixth seal is so is of such a great magnitude that it's causing people to realize something is different. And they're realizing, it says here, that it's the judgment of God. They're realizing it. And they're crying out to the rocks and the mountains, hide us. Meaning, where can we hide from the judgment of God? So that's, that realization is coming upon the people, because they're saying things that are happening now are very, very different. And everyone, whether they're rich or poor, educated or uneducated, everybody's suddenly becoming aware of the wrath of God and the wrath of the Lamb. Who can stand before that, right? So this is the sixth seal when this happens, okay? So now, very interestingly, we've gone through six seals, and then before we can get to the seventh seal, which actually comes to us in the eighth chapter, there's like a small happening, or I'll just say small happening, but there is an interjection of something else that's happening on the earth, which is not connected to these seals that are being opened. Okay, so we've gone through six seals. Each one is saying something's happening here on the earth, and they're very, you know, very, very destructive. People, lots of people are dying. All these things are happening. And then before we get to the eighth seal, chapter seven is telling us, well, something else is happening here on earth. And I'll just make mention of it, and then we'll go for a break. What we will read in chapter seven is that during the tribulation, somewhere from the beginning of the tribulation, the Lord marks 144,000 Jewish men to serve him on the earth during that time. This is very, very significant. You know, we thought that during the church age, you know, God's attention towards the Jewish people had, you know, it's like, okay, where are they now? Well, they have a role to play, even the time to come. And in the tribulation, we are seeing that the Lord has selected 144,000 Jewish men. He is going to mark them by the Holy Spirit with his name on them, and they are going to bear testimony to the Lord Jesus Christ. Jewish people are going to be bearing testimony. We will see that in chapter 7, and then we'll read about them again in the 14th chapter. And so, you know, we will piece this information together, and we will know what they were doing. So generally, they are referred to as the Jewish evangelists, because they have been marked by God, anointed by God, to stand for the name of Jesus during the tribulation. Okay, so we're going to take a little break now. We'll take our 10-minute break. When we come back, we'll get into chapter 7. Okay, see you shortly. Thanks.